today's session with the concept of error flagging. Okay? Error flagging is not a data cleaning process as such, but it's part of it. It's part of it, and it applies with certain key moments when you can do something with your data. So what is error flagging? Well, flagging in general is adding a piece of information to a record, a PBD, or any other type of information. But this concept is adding a piece of information, not changing the original record. And that piece of information gives additional quality-related information. Error flagging is especially used to highlight records so that they can be then more easily extracted. So going more specifically into the error flagging, the error flagging provides a simple way of filtering out records that might be problematic. Filtering out or filtering in. It's adding a piece of information that says, hey, this record has something wrong. So it's very, very useful for automatic error processing. Say we have a list of thousands of records. We have to go one by one checking if there's something wrong with them and modifying it. Even with automatic tools, it will take a very long time. But if we first flag automatically the issues and then make the cleaning processes to just focus on the ones that show a particular value, particular error flag, that will improve a lot the processing time. Besides, error flagging is also very useful for reporting the issues back to the publisher, to the owner of the data. And this is where error flagging comes handy. So you would say, what's the difference between flagging, conceptually, what's the difference between flagging and resolving? So if we have our data, we can directly clean it up. We don't need to flag it. That's an additional step, right? Yes and no. The thing is, flagging comes useful when the data is not ours. We, for example, go to GBIT to download the data from a collection. There are several implications that we must expect when we download that. So if the data is ours, it's our data, we have collected it, we have built the collection, then we are directly responsible for the quality. But if the data is not ours, if we have downloaded it from GB or from Vernet or any other data source aggregator, then we are not directly responsible for the quality. We might have community responsibility of making that data better, but we are not the direct responsible for the quality of that information. And why not? Because when the data is ours, we decide to share it, our version of the data is the real one, is the one to which everybody should refer to, the one to use it. But if the data is not ours, what we do is to point to the original data. We cannot take a collection from anybody else, clean it up, and then republish it as if it was ours. We can't do that. But we can do that if it's our data. So if it's ours, we can directly improve the quality. We can clean the issues before publishing, and then publish a better quality collection. But if the data is not ours, we cannot take it, clean it up, and republish it. We're not allowed to do so. So in these cases, when the data is not ours, it's when error flagging comes handy. And why can't we clean someone else's data and republish it? Because of two main issues, which are attribution and persistence. Attribution is something that we need to respect when working with data from an aggregator. When we download the data from GBIF, there are some restrictions or some conditions that we agree to respect. The most common one is to acknowledge the original source of the data. If we publish any analysis based on that data, we must say, this data has been taken from this collection. Each collection besides might have additional books, but the acknowledgement is common among almost all the collections. We have to acknowledge the source, the original source of the data. So let's suppose we have a collection with extracting information. We want to do an analysis, but first we need to assess if the data is clean enough to make that assessment. And we detect some problems. So now let's suppose we don't respect this, and we publish our analysis without, we publish our analysis, it results in a paper now, high quality paper. We have to acknowledge the original source of the data. We have to say this data has come from this publisher. So when the publisher goes and sees the, our analysis, they might get a bit angry because that's not their data. Even though it's better, that's not their version of the data. And we might have introduced errors when doing our cleaning process. So they say, hey, this is my original data. You should have used this one, not say that we have this version of the data. So the thing to do is once we discover these issues, we have to report. We have to say we found this. In the paper itself, say we have taken the information from this publisher and found this issue, this issue, this issue, and have cleaned it up. Then you can publish it, and the original publisher have to say that you, as a researcher, are acknowledging the original source and acknowledging that you have made some progress to the information. So that's what I mean. The attribution part of the plan. What about the persistence? Persistence of the improvements, persistence of the corrections. If we work with somebody else's data locally, these corrections, these improvements are not persistent, are not permanent outside our limits. It will be permanent for us, but if another researcher wants to download the same data set, they won't come take our information, they will go to the original publisher, where the data won't be cleaned up. So they will have to repeat all the assessment, all the cleaning effort. So error flagging is here an excellent tool for reporting these kind of issues. We can clean the data for ourselves, but the thing is, with error flagging, we can report the issues we found back to the original publisher, so they can fix it. Once we got it, the owners can fix the data, and then we publish a better, cleaner version of the data, so the next researcher will have data with our improvements. The best example of flagging, in general, is the concept of annotations. Annotations is adding pieces of information to taxonomic description, locality, any other piece of information that adds information about it. So what are the mechanisms for error flagging? Error flagging belongs to the data manipulation, which is adding a piece of information to the original record, as I already said. And that is reflected in the existence of new fields. We are adding fields to our collection, to our tables, to our spreadsheets, that might be populated or not, depending on if there are errors. If a record is clean, the flagging field will be empty. So here the recommendation is to use and document how have you used a specific type of encoder, codifying the flags. And why? Because let's suppose we find that among our collection or the collection we have taken, there are several records that have these coordinates swapped, the latitude in the longitude field and the longitude in the latitude. So if we manually enter that information, we might be producing errors such as some of the times putting coordinates swapped, other times putting swapped coordinates, the times coordinate transposed, even introduce typos. You see here the word coordinates, there's an I missing. use a codification, say if we change all this by a number of one, if in the flag field we put just one, that's easier to do, and it's less prone to errors. And any possible way of writing coordinate swap won't cause any trouble. Then we must have another, separate text file or whatever, list of codes that explains that one means coordinate swap.